Hey guys, this is Insurance and Finance Live from the headquarters of Digitalscouting in the rainy city of Hamburg, Germany. Today, we have a very special guest in our Superstar Series. After Gary Vaynerchuk, Guy Kawasaki, Graham Cadone, we have Rachel Cruze here from the country music capital of the world, Nashville. And as a diehard country fan, I sneak this one in. Rachel, thank you very much for being here.
Yes, thank you for having me. I'm so excited to talk with you.
Yeah, for the two people in the audience that might not know you, Rachel Cruze, best-selling author, New York Times best-selling author, financial expert, Ramsey personality, one of America's most popular sources in finance, in money, in also life questions. Therefore, we are super happy to have you here to talk about and talk to the insurance and finance community.
Absolutely. Well, I'm so thankful to be here. And all the work you do and your whole show, everything, I'm like, yes, educating people when it comes to money, I think is so, so important. So I love all the stuff that you're doing.
Yeah. And we will also use this show not only to put it to the LinkedIn community, but also we have like the biggest finance community on TikTok. So we'll do a lot of TikTok videos about it. Yes.
I'm not a model. I don't dance, but
we're on TikTok. So we will use this also on TikTok. But my first question I always ask people from outside the industry is, how do you and your family buy insurance today?
How do we buy insurance today? We use an insurance broker. And again, it may be different in Germany, so I'm not sure how similar this is. So we use a company, that helps shop all different insurance rates. So when it comes to personal finance for me, there are sectors of this world that I am not the expert in. So whether it's insurance, really, really deep investing, I would say, like the day-to-day investing, taxes. You know, there's a couple of things that myself, I'm like, I want to bring in professionals that do this day in and day out. This is the world they live in, the air they breathe. So I kind of put insurance in that for me. So there is a company, a brokerage that we use for all of our insurance. And they always shop the best rates. That's what I love about them. They're competitive. It's not one company that's just their insurance. They shop a bunch of different companies. So try to get the best rate possible. Save the money, because insurance can be expensive. And I feel like it is one area that people set, you know, for years, and they never go back and look to see how much they're paying. So thankfully, we check up on it at least once a year to see what's going on.
Very good. I think that two messages in there, the brokers in our audience will love what you say right now. And the second one, of course, is you need to update, have a look at your insurance. If you do not care for them, they don't care for you when you need them. In emergency case, sometimes that might happen. One thing I heard also you talk about in your shows about term life insurance, and insurance that's super dear to me too. Here in Europe, we say you should cover your mortgage with your term life insurance, but you actually say, or what I heard you on your show saying is 10 times your annual income. Why?
Well, if something does happen to you and there is someone dependent upon your income in your life, whether it's a spouse, whether it's kids, I think the best gift you can give them is that through that process of losing you, which is always a hard conversation, right? It's like talking about death, but it's a reality. We all, it's going to happen to all of us. But to say, okay, when that happens financially, to be in a spot where finances is not a burden and you can still be able to live the life you are living, you may have to get other resources, right? So if it's a stay-at-home mom, for instance, I always say to have around $500,000 on her, because you're going to have to pay for someone to help with the kids, maybe even just do laundry. I mean, help around the house, right? If you are a dad and you lose a wife, or if you're a wife and you lose a husband and you lose that income. So the best bet is for it to just not shake the family, because there's already so much that's going on in that moment. So financially, yes, to be able to say, okay, 10 times our income, here's where we can be. And again, you may not have to use all of it by any means of year to year, but to be able for it to be a supplement, that's a huge gift. Because sadly, I know probably in your world too, you hear so many stories of people that don't have insurance. And besides just the grief of losing someone, there's this whole other mess that they're having to deal with. So to be able to alleviate that side, I think is really crucial. So life insurance and term life is so inexpensive too.
Yes.
So everyone needs it.
I know. I was once an agent, and when I saw a young family, I always, you know, I would not say made them buy term life insurance, but it's really, really economic. And in the moment of sadness, it can help people. But it was really an aha moment for myself to not only say, let's not cover the mortgage and have then a huge financial crisis in addition to the emotional crisis, but actually let's not accept the fact that we should lower our standard of living only because we lost a loved one, even though, you know, the insurance is so cheap. Okay, that are all insurance questions I really love promise it. To you, okay? Thank you very much for that. Let's talk about one thing. When I'm on conferences around the world, and I always ask my friends in the industry two things when we get a little bit more private, you know, not like at first. I ask them, how do you manage your money? Open question. And how do you prepare for retirement? And I do not ask it because I'm mean, but I'm super interested in because I don't want to miss something. And and I hear a lot of times, I don't. And I think that's a problem in Germany. We have the saying, a shoemaker has the worst shoes. Probably that's for insurance and finance people too when it comes to retirement and financial planning. But how could we, or so professionals, get control of all the euros and dollars disappearing each month?
It's a great question. So to answer the first, how do I manage my money? The first word that came to my mind was a budget. And people, I was just talking to two friends about this literally just yesterday because we were talking about it, and they were like, oh, budgeting, Rachel, do you really like, you know, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, we were talking about it. And I was like, yes, because the word budget has gotten a bad rap. People think the word budget means you can't have any fun. You can never travel. You can never go on vacation. You can never shop. You have to like live and collect coupons and lint. And that's all you know, that's your life. And I'm like, no, that is not budgeting. Budgeting is permission to spend. When you budget, yes, you are telling your money where to go. You are saying, okay, this is how much we're spending on food this month. This is how much our mortgage is. This is how much if we have our insurance that we have to pay this month. Here is our cell phone bill. Here is where we're paying money out. And we're going to just make a plan and say, yes, this is the amount of money we're going to put in each category. And so what that does is, yes, it gives you guardrails. It gives you boundaries. So you will have to say no to yourself at times to say, okay, not this month, because that category of out to eat is getting really low. So we're going to choose to eat in tonight. You know, there are choices you're going to have to make in it. But it gives you the freedom and the peace of mind knowing that your hard-earned money, like you work hard for money, right? We all, you get up early, you sacrifice time away from your family. Some people, you sit in traffic to get to an office. If you're back in an office, I mean, like there are sacrifices we make to go to work and make money. So you want that money to work for you and not just squander it and look up, like you said, at the end of the month and say, where did all my euros, where did all my dollars go? And so this plan gives you just peace of mind. It gives you boundaries, but it also allows you when you spend not to have guilt and shame around it. And I'm a natural spender. I love spending money. I'm more of a spender than a saver naturally. And so whenever I would, you know, go shopping or get on Amazon, my Amazon app, and do something, if I didn't have a budget, I know myself, I would be questioning and thinking, ugh, is this okay? I'd feel bad that I'm like buying this, you know. But with a budget, I'm like, no, I have a line item that I know I can spend money in this category, and it's freedom. It's freedom for me to be able to do it. So a budget is really big for me. And I think and my husband and I, we work together. So if you're married out there watching, work together, have one budget that you both have a say in and you both agree. That could be a whole other interview in and of itself. It's just marriage and money, because it's a big topic. But really, that is, when you said, how do you manage your money? A budget is my number one. It gives purpose to my paycheck. And then retirement. So what we teach at Ramsey Solutions is a couple of steps before retirement, actually. So I want people to have $1,000 emergency fund in cash, in the bank, somewhere that you can get to it easily. And then that's your first goal. And then I want you completely debt-free, except for your mortgage. And a lot of people are like, what? But I preach all the day is long about debt-free living. I think being debt-free is so, so crucial, not only to your financial health, but also your stress, your options in life. Like when you have no debt, there is such power that you've put back into your life. And so getting out of debt is a big one. So I teach getting out of debt, smallest amount of debt, the smallest debt to the largest. regardless of the interest rates, pay minimum payments on everything, and pay off that smallest debt first and work your way through. So people that do this, we call it the debt snowball, because you gain traction, gain momentum, and it gets bigger and bigger because you have more money to throw at your debts. And people are getting completely debt-free in 18 to 24 months doing this. Yeah. So it's possible. And then from there, once you're debt-free, build up that larger emergency fund. Take your $1,000 and build it up to 3 to 6 months worth of expenses. So I see this amount of money, like we were talking earlier, I see this more as like an insurance yeah. versus an investment. So don't invest it. This is just in case something happens. This is your emergency fund is there. And then is when you can look at retirement. So we fund 15, and what I teach people to do is 15% of your income into retirement. And again, in the States, it might, I think it's probably different in Germany, but we have 401ks here. So to take the match there with your employer. And we have an option called a Roth IRA. So those are two great retirement options for investing that I do personally, my husband does, and I recommend for people.
Yeah. And one thing I found, I have to confess, Rachel, I was a money messy, you know, I was early on making some good money, but I was so, and let's talk about your money classrooms in a minute. I was so holding on to this money that I should have invested it, but didn't invest it for a long, long time until I understood you need to let go of it. You know, if your money sits around, it gets bored. So everything above the emergency fund, your definition of emergency fund really helped me to understand the rest I should actually invest. And another thing is, for the two people out there that do not know the baby steps, it has helped millions and millions and millions of Americans to get out of debt. So, you know, if you have an idea to do it better, probably you just go to the baby steps, because it has helped millions and millions of people around the world.